We just had a fantastic panel on Brazilian music and musicians in four cities. Really exciting panels, which leads very nicely, I think, into this round table. Lizzie pointed out it's not a round table, it's a straight one. Where the focus moves here, to London. And what I thought is that we could go beyond, you know, the academic sphere, the sphere of academic research, and invite some of what I consider to be, you know, the most important representatives of Brazilian musical activity, artistry, activism, education, you know, who are currently working in the city. And to think a bit more about the experience of musicians, teachers, activists, to hear something of their perspective on what it means to battle on behalf of Brazilian music here, to hear about some of the possibilities, but also some of the difficulties, some of the challenges, and maybe ideas that you have. So what I'll do is I'll introduce very quickly, give a very quick introduction to each of them in turn. And then what I'm going to ask is for each of them to talk a little bit about their experience, their perspective on things. Maybe raise one or two questions, which we can take up in discussion. And then I've got a couple of questions that I might put to the panel as a whole, and we can begin to open things up. I mean, I was struck when I was at the show Magina da Vila Fabiana with other people the other night. Immediately as we arrived, we had leaflets thrust in our hands advertising shows, you know, later in the year. João do Mato, Mer Pascoal is going to be playing. I think Catan Veloso and Gilberto Gia, I think, they're coming back,
really?
I think so, yeah. So, you know, there's an endless kind of program of, you know, big stars coming to the major, you know, cultural centers like the Barbican, like the South Bank. There's also, of course, an ongoing program of local venues, either permanent venues like Guanabara and other places, País do Brasil, which host, you know, smaller acts for local, sometimes specialized kind of audiences and genres. So there is a world beyond the world of MPB, for example. There's Forró, there's Gacetanejo, everything is kind of on offer. And then there's the world of people who are making their living or trying to make their living, who live here permanently, Brazilians and non-Brazilians, actually. Some of those at the table here, who have an ongoing commitment to work with Brazilian music and also to work with local audiences, constituencies, communities to promote that music. So let me do some quick introductions. We have on my far left, Lizzie Owen, who's a first-year PhD student here at King's, working on Maracatu de Nação and Canelon Blair, and the sort of politics of race, culture, and so on, and religion that surround those activities. But she's also very active in the Brazilian music scene in the UK and here in London. She is the assistant director of Maracatu Estrela do Norte. I'm sure she's going to talk about that in a minute. She's involved with other groups too, including a female percussion and vocal quartet, Let Drum Beat. So that's Lizzie. Guy, who's immediately to my left, well, we've been friends for quite a long time. How long have you been living in London?
13 years.
He, you know, had a career as an events organizer, as a musician in Brazil before he came here. Has worked with lots of Brazilian musicians before. He has recorded two, has an album, Amigos and Friends, I think it was If Friends, or I think it was And Friends.
And Friends.
And Friends. Amongst other recordings. I've known him as a wonderful leader of a Brazilian vocal group, Nossa Voz, which has been active for a number of years. Proud to be a member of that group. We perform every year, several times a year, with fantastic repertoires. He is an amazing arranger, an amazing leader of that group. He's now developed a new group, sprung out of Nossa Voz, Cantar. And he's also on the Brazilian music scene. You hear him playing, performing. He's a teacher also. So that's he. He will tell us more about himself. To my right is Clary Iluzum, who's very well known, I think, to concert goers, regular concert goers here, as a concert pianist. Has a very busy international career as well, beyond London, as a soloist, and performed very widely here, Europe, and the Americas, and Asia, and of course, you tour in Brazil every year too, and has a number of very successful CDs. The broad repertoire, Latin American composers through to the classical repertoire, and this is in German particular. And to my far right here is Monica Vasconcelos, a very close, very dear friend too, dear collaborator. Monica has more than 20 years career here as a performing musician, as a singer here, as well as an important career as a journalist within the BBC World Service. So managing those two careers at once, which I know is a challenge. Celebrated those 20 years quite recently with a number of shows. Is to be seen in many venues around London. I've seen her most of all, I think, in the Vortex, but you'll see her performing with various musicians. I think a real sort of force to be reckoned with, and really committed, as I'm sure we'll hear, to not just performing for Brazilian audiences, but performing very much for UK local audiences, and to transmitting, conveying something of the artistry of Brazilian song to those audiences. So I'm going to ask everyone, sort of in reverse order, to talk a little bit more from their own perspective about their experiences and thoughts, really, about what it is to be a Brazilian musician, musical activist in this city. What are the possibilities and also maybe some of the challenges. So can I start with you, Monica?
Okay. I thought, what could be my contribution? And I thought of four little stories that happened to me, and I thought that they might be useful, they might be interesting subject for perhaps a conversation later on. I think the first story is of a young 20-something woman who arrives in London, and all she cares about is music, it's been like that since her teenage years. And she arrives here and she's lucky to meet this amazing group of musicians, jazz musicians mostly, composers, arrangers, playing at very high level, playing international artists, touring all over the world, who accept her invitation to join her band. And not only they start giving her beautiful tunes and music for her to start experimenting with the first, attempts at writing lyrics. And why should these guys at such level, be willing to work with this unknown Brazilian person? And to me, that's the strength. It's not due to their beautiful eyes. It's to do with the strength of Brazilian music. How incredibly powerful, accomplished, brilliant Brazilian music is in all the important levels: harmony, harmonically, melodically, rhythmically, and the lyrical content is the one that audiences here tend to miss. But for jazz musicians, Brazilian music is just paradise. And so that's how it all begins. Another story is that this singer, musician, starts making records and doing gigs, and then she will occasionally do interviews, and one of the very first interviews she does, a radio presenter, I don't even know who this person is, or even the radio station, you know, car, it's like 20 years ago. He asks her live, you know, on air, on the radio, over the phone, "So what's this thing about samba? Why do people like it? Is it to do with the body contact?" So that's, you know, and that immediately became subject for a song, for, you know, lyrics for a song. That's one experience, body contact, samba. And then the third story I could tell is, again, this singer is invited to sing at the Andy Cashel show, and the Cashel really respected Jay. You know, she sings a few times in his program. One of the last times she sings at his program, which no longer exists, and again, you know, from early 1990s to now, it's a shame. There is a lot of space for Brazilian music, I think. And so he's asking her, "So what sort of music did you listen to as, you know, as a kid or a teenager?" And she says, "Well, to be honest, I didn't want to listen to any foreign music. I was into Brazilian music." And and she cannot understand why there is this feeling of disapproval in his, "So what do you mean? It's, you know, and what have I said, you know, and why can't he understand?" And then it took her a while to realize that, how do you explain a culture? How do you explain that you were born under a military dictatorship in Brazil, that 60s and 70s, at least in my opinion, were the climax of Brazilian production in terms of music. I mean, I'm not sure if we ever, you know, we've gone further in terms of brilliancy or whatever. You know, I think that it's the climax of production in Brazilian music. And then that's 60s and 70s in Brazil. And then that's the music she kind of cut her teeth on. So that's the music she fell in love with, and that's inside her, and that's the music she brought with her in her rucksack. But before she comes here, she's at university, and by the time she gets to university in the 80s, it's not cool to listen to Brazilian music anymore. And the radio stations in Brazil have been completely taken over by foreign music. And, you know, music which is performed in English in a very poor country where most of the population do not speak English. And by the time she's at university, she goes to the university parties, and all her colleagues find it really uncool to be into Brazilian music. What's cool is to be into English rock, American rock, you know, how could I explain, or could she explain to Andy Cashel that, in her view, it was almost an act of cultural resistance to be into Brazilian music when she was growing up, because it wasn't cool. The fourth story I could tell is that of a man who was directing or in charge of a record label in London. Actually, it belongs to a major record company, and he's interested in doing an album of forró in Baião. And so he's talking to some Brazilian person who turns to him and says, "Oh no, man, you don't want to do that. That's music for maids and truck drivers, forró in Baião." And I think that there is a connection between making this music, you know, cool and interesting, and what was happening in Brazil by the time I left. So it's a funny little story. Yeah. I think this interview with Andy Kershaw particularly, I think I was misunderstood. I think that there were a few DJs at the time who then refused to review my record. I think that is always the difficulty in explaining a culture and the big battle, fighting stereotypes and trying to explain something that's so hard to explain. I guess you have to experience the culture, you have to go there, or you have to rely on people like David trying to explain this culture. Okay, so I hope it's useful.
Any sort of conclusions after 20 years of singing, performing, being active, and reflecting on that length of time? A long time, being here and being part of the music scene, Brazilian music scene and non-Brazilian music scene here. Any sort of conclusions?
Conclusions in which sense?
I don't know really. About what it means to be in that role.
In comparison to say, someone like Chico or Gil, the big guy who we all kind of, our idols are, they are everything for me. I think what we do is we will go to the tiny places in this country and take the music there and explain it and try to do the best we can to explain this music. And so we take it places where the major artists in Brazil take them because they just place the structure to do that. So it's a real pleasure. It's a wonderful thing. Because the music is so immediate, it's so powerful. Music doesn't, they don't get the lyrics anyway, but music is something that doesn't get to you through your head. It never went through it gets you in your heartbeat. And it's so powerful. I think, it's a pleasure and it's almost a mission as well, because it's becoming harder and harder to make music nowadays. Music that's not commercial, that's not commercial. It's become a mission.
And that's an experience of shared, that's not unique to Brazilian music, that's a general problem to musicians in this country.
When you're doing music that's not this sort of industrial music, that's to do with, which is to do with art, which has, I'm not religious, but I still think of music as something spiritual. I don't know what to call it. I mean, it's something that it's not to do with making money, basically. Of course, I do my best to do gigs and to get good fees, particularly for the musicians I work with, because lots of them are of music. But generally, if you are playing some sort of music, you are not in it for the money anyway. And,
just one other little question before we move on to the thing. I mean, what strikes me is actually that you always work with both Brazilian and non-Brazilian musicians. I think all of your bands have a combination. Anything to say about that? That seems to be very important aspect of what you do.
Yeah, it is, yeah. Well, I've always been crazy about jazz, despite telling Andy Kershaw I didn't listen to any foreign music. And I think that that combination for me is irresistible, improvised music and Brazilian music all together. think there is this beautiful cross-fertilization, if you can call it like that, where, you know, for instance, Steve Lauder, pianist, I've worked with him for 20 years, written lots of music with him, songs and things. He's an incredible player with amazing experience and solid background, like solid formation, if you can call it like that. You know, studied at Cambridge and did music, he played the piano since he was 8 years old. When did you start? Very good. But this guy would marvel, say, at a Jobim song, you know, just going around the Jobim harmonies and saying, wow, you can put that chord, how amazing. So, you know, it's such a pleasure to share this music and make sure it's cherished and it's taken forward, because that's something I'm not very good at in Brazil, let's face it. I mean, to value our culture, to cherish it. I mean, how on earth is Bossa Nova considered uncool? I heard lots of people telling that Bossa Nova, forget Bossa Nova. You know, why are you still talking about Bossa Nova? As if you could forget something, you know, as if you would say this to the British state, yeah, forget Shakespeare, it's over, you know. I mean, it's the kind of thing that it will happen in Brazil. Anyway, we can talk so much about that. I'm trying to explain, but I feel that I'm kind of, in a very tiny way, but I'm kind of keeping it alive and giving it to these people, you know, to the musicians who were my friends and my ultimate family. You know? It's
fantastic. Thanks, Monica. So, Clelia, what is it like to be a Brazilian concert pianist, based here, moving around?
It's like a different world of all me. I also came here very young. I came here, I was still a teenager, in the early 80s, and I studied sporadically, then went to the Royal Academy. I didn't plan to stay my life here. I think just that one thing led to another one, and I ended up, you know, my home here. In this, it's interesting because since my childhood, I always had contact with the classical composers, you know, Brazilian composers. Obviously, Villa-Lobos has always been the one very known since my childhood. I also knew other composers such as Francisco Mignoni, who I happen to know, and personally I played for him, and he wrote a piece dedicated to me when I was 13 years old. This sort of thing was, you know, very, very important in my early career. And then when I came here to study and I started getting my first concerts, my teachers at the time said, no, you have to play on the big repertoire because you know, you're a young pianist, you have to show you can play Beethoven sonatas, you can play on big romantic pieces. And I said, but maybe I should put include a Brazilian piece in there. Oh no, we shouldn't put this, you know, I have to play all the big repertoire, you know, prove yourself as a good, but you know, I can prove myself with Villa-Lobos, I have with the Mignoni as well. No. So eventually I start, you know, putting one piece in a concert here, and I remember in my Wigmo Hall debut recital, I put a Villa-Lobos piece. And it went very well. The critics said, oh, well, that piece is very, maybe almost 30 years ago, Villa-Lobos still a name you said, people said, it's getting better now, you know, I don't get that solo anymore, but so I played a piece there, and then I started playing lots of music societies as well. I have a very good network of concerts here, so I started putting a bit more. He added different composers, even something a little bit more popular, like Ernesto Nazaré. And I always got a very, very positive response from the public and from experts, you know, as well, okay, you know, critics and things like that. So I said, I think, you know, I have to believe it's good. I always believe, but I can see that it is working. And in the part I can do is promote and play more of this music. So I did lots of premieres as well, even Villa-Lobos premiere here. I played an octet that Villa-Lobos played in the week, the semana,
yeah,
he had made an arrangement. So I played that with musicians, not Brazilian musicians, English musicians, which I think is the great thing, is to get the interest of the local musicians as well. Because, of course, I've always played that, but when I play it with a bridge quartet or something, it gives even more pleasure because I can see that they are also believing it in what I've been trying to get across for a long time. And I think that's how the composers get into the repertoire of the universal repertoire. Like nobody thinks of Chopin anymore, the Polish composer who was played by Polish pianists. Now it's played by everybody. So I think the day, maybe I'll not see this, will be in the future, but I will see that the Brazilian music is great composers who deserve a place next to the Shostakovichs and Stravinsky of the 20th century will be played by everybody. And I want to think specifically that they are Brazilian composer. It's a composer that has become universal. So I mean, that is a dream that we are working towards it. I can do maybe a small part by playing and by bringing the unknown names. Like Henrique Oswald is a composer from the 19th century. He's a romantic composer. And I finally made a premiere of his piano quintet here in Portugal a few years ago. And I've been played here. And it was a beautiful piece. It's romantic. Nobody says it's challenging, it's strange, you know. It is a romantic piece by a composer who deserves a place in the repertoire of of musicians in general. So from this experience, I started a festival, which I did 3 editions so far, very successful. It's called Brazil 3 Centuries of Music. And I got support from the embassy for the first one, this one I did at the South Bank. And I did 2 more editions with some sponsorships, just have to run after people and get a little bit of from here and there to do and to play composers, also living composers that in Brazil, like Magnus Nobre, Ronaldo Miranda, and some even younger composers. And so this idea it grew to a point now that I'm starting a charity. It's called Polifonia. I'm funding this. So it is a charity which will be dedicated to promoting music from the Americas. In fact, we decided to put Americas because there is a lot in the other countries also, Latin America, and also North America, which are also related. So we are in the process of opening it, and our aim is to make concerts. Also, an important part of this is to get like manuscripts. There are lots of scores in Brazil. I'm always at the library in Rio de Janeiro. When I enter there, I can see them all and say, oh no, because I'm going to get lots of things and ask them to copy and get out with a bunch of music. And there are some manuscripts that are deteriorating there, and I'm in terrible state. So one of the aims that eventually I hope what it starts to get some of these scores and putting them in a good format, and eventually putting them also in the internet, so people can download them. It is happening already. There is a lot happening in this sense there. Like Ernesto Nazaré, which I recorded recently, all his music is available online now. So just have to get and download it. So I mean, eventually this will help the availability of people to get this score to play. So actually some Villa-Lobos scores are not playable, are still in manuscript form, and you look at it and say, oh my god, what is what? It's crazy. That's a detective work to find what it is. So I think, you know, I think in here I can see that it's a lot happening. It's a lot more public and interest in the classical aspect of Brazilian music, and I think the future looks bright.
It's good to hear that. Yeah, it's really interesting hearing you talk about the Brazilian repertoire. And you know, you might imagine that you know, somebody in your position would feel a kind of responsibility or an obligation to promote that. But for you, it's obviously something you've done, you know, with absolute love and dedication. You don't have to feel an obligation about you. It's just part of what you do.
When you live, like when I left Brazil, sometimes I say maybe I saw Brazil from a distance and I felt the responsibility because then I carry the name Brazil with me in me, you know, so I'm more aware of how good this music is.
There's a very particular experience you were talking about. Given that, as you said, you know, this is still identified as Brazilian music rather than as a part of the, you know, canon or the sort of the repertoire. Oh, that's very interesting, I think, to be in that position.
Yeah, this perception is still beginning to, you know, I think it will eventually begin to change. Obviously, Tchaikovsky was Russian, Pump is our Polish, but the perception of this, you know, extra repertoire, not part of the main repertoire, still not quite.
It's kind of making its way, exactly.
I mean, it was played in the last night of the Proms, and you know, there was one festival in Barbican, and you see orchestra playing from there, so it's great to see this.
Fantastic, thanks, Claudia. So, tell us about being in Havaris.
It's the same of Martinho yesterday. I prefer to read to get my ideas in a good way. Thank you very much for the opportunity of taking part of this round square table discussion at City to City event. It's a privilege to be here sharing my words with others and to learn what they have to say about experiencing Brazilian culture. I think London is great to work and enjoy living in the city because of its diversity. There are so many opportunities of cultural exchange and growing here. Cosmopolitan cities like London have more sources to offer that. I moved here 13 years ago, as I said. From this time, I've had many opportunities to develop myself as a producer, leader, educator, musician, by embracing what professionals and other non-Brazilians have to offer. I'm going to briefly talk about the activities I run in London this time. There are three projects, mainly. The first one is called the Nossa Voz Vocal Group in Twitter. The second one is called the Greater Brazil. And the third one, the part of Greater Brazil, is called Minas Heart of Brazil. Number one, Nossa Voz, that means our voice. Once I arrived in the UK, I noticed that it was an interest in learning and singing Brazilian songs. Nossa Voz was founded in 2004. The first meeting and rehearsals were at the reception of Latin Hostel in Finsbury Park. Now the group practices at King's College and has participated in festivals and concerts. It's an amateur group formed by enthusiastic people from various nationalities and backgrounds who get together to sing Brazilian music and celebrate its culture. We aim to bring to the project a lot of our history through music, and every 2 years we work on a new theme. We mix voices and musical arrangements with the theatrical elements and prepare participants for that by providing lessons with professional musicians, singers, body movements, and stage coaches. On a social level, we see people from the group forming strong friendships every year. We are happy to say that Nossa Voz counts on enthusiastic support of several people and institutions, including King's College, London, Embassy of Brazil, and Syracuse University. Number two, Creative Brazil. It's an organization with a broader artistic reach. Our team also comes from different nationalities and backgrounds and work within music, education, theater, dance, crafts and visual arts. We aim to promote a better understanding of the Brazilian culture and through the joy of participating in creative practice. We bring opportunities to artists and tutors. Participants increase their music knowledge and well-being through activities. And number three, Minas Art in Brazil. This is a multimedia event which brings to London the arts of the state of Minas Gerais, promotes collaboration and exchange between Brazil and London-based artists, communities and audiences. The project focuses both on the region's rural artisan traditions, pageantry, cuisine, handcrafts, contemporary cultures of its urban communities, music, theater, literature and cinema. In terms of teaching, I have the opportunity to review many facts, topics and moments I learned in the past in my country and adapt them to share this knowledge with my group, students and audience. This point brings to us a new understanding, keeps people updated and makes all lives fresh. For instance, taking an old song and making a new arrangement gives to it a second life, I may say. Also, each person is able to contribute with their own creativity in a group work, enrich the creation and perform process. It opens a great spectrum of possibilities. Now, I'd like to mention about challenges of promoting Brazilian music in London. Challenge one, music market. As metropolis, London is a place where you find your openness to embrace new cultures, also a lot to see. There are music from all different parts of the world, so there are a lot of competition. I think each musician and artist needs to be able to find his own niche, create an original product and work on it. I'm also a songwriter and never forget to have something new every year. Challenge two, cultural difference. The Brazilian way of doing things is slightly different from British way. So, I think this is the first thing as a foreign artist has to face here to understand how the system operates. We need to balance between using the creativity or playing by the technique. I can mention about music improvisation. For example, when I started attending open mics and jam sessions in East London, 2004, 2005, I was impressed by the quality of the participants. Some of them were incredibly good on improvisation, but they stopped it and really enjoyed when I played in some groups just created on the day, playing simple Brazilian music patterns on the piano, guitar, or singing. The final results were overwhelming, everybody played together. Challenge three, cliches and stereotypes. It's a challenge to break them. Some styles of Brazilian music have been overused. Because of the market interest in big audience in all the world, people may be missing out all the beautiful styles and all its variations. Brazil has a lot of undiscovered art treasures to be shown and explored. About support for Brazilian activities. Our group has appreciated the constant support of important organizations such as Arts Council of England in two projects, Arts Council of England already, Embassy of Brazil, and the private sector, business companies in London. These partnerships offered opportunities to artists to share Brazilian art to British audiences. It's really gratifying for me to work with London audiences and participants in our activities. We found here many people that understand how important is the diversity in arts to have a great inspirational world. The interaction and response is great. There are things that you can learn in books, but living here, I experience it's something else. Art is in constant transformation, so there are no limits in the possibilities of promoting Brazilian music in London, in UK. There are many things that you can learn and teach of each culture and history. The enthusiasm opens new horizons. Finalizing, the role of Brazilian community in London. You cannot isolate yourself. You need to embrace the openness you find here. Take advantage to learn and grow with the culture that is waiting for you. That's the cultural exchange to enrich the diversity. Thank you.
Fantastic, Guy. I just wanted to ask you about two things, really, comment on two things. One is, I think, an aspect of your work which is really interesting, which is to challenge, go beyond, question a bit some of the expectations. You know, you talked about cliches and stereotypes. I'm not sure whether it was Amanda's paper talking about expectations of, you know, what is the real Brazilian thing, you know, in Lisbon. And I think one of her examples was somebody saying, well, you're not going to play any other music. And, you know, I really struck, you know, this ongoing project with Minas. You know, Minas is one of the kind of, you know, forgotten. For people here, it's one of the unknown aspects, but major aspects. Regions of Brazilian cultural, social, and historical life. So I think it's a very interesting thing to do, to decide to not to go with the flow, not to simply take the easy option of Bahia, Rio, probably, but to actually focus on, you know, a really precious aspect of Brazilian culture, which isn't really known about here. So that's one thing I want to just to sort of highlight. The other thing I think is your work with non-Brazilians, actually. You know, as being somebody who's you know, been part of myself for a few years now, one of the things I still find very moving, and I think people are really impressed by, is this isn't a group of, you know, local Brazilians, there are Brazilians involved, but it's very, very multinational. And not only do people with absolutely no experience of speaking Portuguese reach a really high level of Portuguese in their singing, because singing, of course, is the best way to learn a language, actually. And people are very impressed by that. But I think also their connection with the music, with the culture, with the way of singing is really impressive. And I think there's a whole transformation that goes on with those people. Something really new, and I always find that very, very moving. That's something very particular to the kind of work that you do with just people, you know, who may have some connection with Brazil, but sometimes they're just interested in singing and they think Brazilian music is interesting, and then they are really, you know, brought fully into that immersion in Brazilian culture. And that's a really wonderful thing. So maybe that's something we can talk about.
Yeah, two things about Minas. One thing about Minas, we started a project in a meeting with a class pianist from Minas Gerais that came to London called Gilberto Mauro and intend to have a project. And so we had lots of meetings 2 years before the starting of the project. Minas was in 2012. And then we brought Minas Gerais and then we have discovered that many people enjoyed Minas song, including your group. They play percussion from Minas Gerais, from Congado that Martinho mentioned yesterday. Congado Mineiro was part of African influence here. So it's, everything was linked. The second point you stressed was important because it also brings people, non-Brazilians, to explore the things that apart from exactly the big mass music that come from Rio de Janeiro in Bahia, and then explore that from Aracatu, from Recife, from Minas Gerais, and other states, people, they just request something. And people from Rio Grande do Sul, they say, why not you have the Rio Grande do Sul? Yeah, but it's not with Minas Gerais, we're from Minas, mostly from Minas, but it was nice.
Yeah.
And everything together, we put them together, Minas, the project, and people bring a group with a skin or different experience from Minas Gerais song, and then no Brazilians that they learn Portuguese through Mineres, that the different Portuguese.
Thanks, Guy. So Lizzie, you have something of a similar kind of experience because you both perform, and as Guy said, Mineiro Mask is a big part of that. But we also work with non-Brazilians.
Yeah, very much so.
On an educational level.
I'm obviously coming from a completely different perspective to the rest of the people on the table. It's a real pleasure to be on this table, even though it's not round. I'm not Brazilian, I'm from Scotland. I started playing in percussion groups, Brazilian percussion groups, when I was 15 in Scotland. And now I'm part of various groups in the UK, both community groups, so amateur groups and professional groups and semi-professional groups, and all the kind of spaces in between those ways of being musical. And I also have started to run a group here at King's. We rehearse here at King's, who you're going to see tomorrow. A mixture of Brazilians and non-Brazilians, professionals and non-professionals, original compositions and traditional music, all of those mixtures in one kind of entity. So let's see what you think about that. For today I wanted to just share a few of my observations, particularly about the phenomenon of playing maracatu in the UK, and the complex and in London particularly, and all the complexities that are involved in that as a non-Brazilian. So I teach and I help to direct maracatu Estrela do Norte with Sam Alexander, who is a English guy who lived in Pernambuco for a time, and when he came back, he kind of transformed the world of the landscape of community music in the UK to an extent, not single-handedly, but to an extent. And so Estrela do Norte was the first maracatu group playing maracatu de Baquedirado. I'm going to touch a lot on some of the themes that Emilia talked about in her presentation. Really interesting kind of overlap with what she was saying. It was the first group in the UK to start playing that kind of music, and one of the first in Europe as well. And Sam actually set up the first encontro that Emilia was talking about, of maracatus in Europe, bringing together all the community groups that are playing this type of music around Europe. Now there are loads of maracatus in the UK, Scotland, Bristol, Manchester, Brighton, Leamington Spa.
Belfast
as well, yeah. In London there is a particular dynamic because of the nature of London. So the group has a big mixture of nationalities, as you were saying about your group as well. Actually, at the moment, around half of the group in London are Brazilian. Mainly Brazilians who never played before they came to the UK, but now, on being in the UK, want to connect or reconnect with their cultural heritage or some part of their cultural heritage. And the rest of the people are people like me who are constantly searching for groove and good rhythms and
have a passion for this kind of music. And there's a lot of movement and exchange between Pernambuco and London and the UK and other European countries. So often we receive messages of Maracatu Nações to refine our practices and to educate us about the meaning of the music in Pernambuco and also to strengthen connections between the two worlds, the two countries. Playing Maracatu Bapirado is in the UK and in London is a really complicated thing. And like all cultural movements, the world of Maracatu in Brazil and in Europe is highly political. It's marked, it's kind of riddled with discord and power struggles, as well as the sharing of beautiful music and very important, often underrepresented knowledge. In particular, I'm constantly dealing with these tensions. I'm constantly kind of, thinking about them. In particular, I see tensions around issues of representation and around who has the right to represent this tradition or these traditions that are born out of centuries of racial and religious discrimination and struggle. There are tensions around notions of cultural appropriation, money, visibility. Particularly around groups like Estrela do Norte and around many other groups that play in Europe, receiving money for playing shows, often playing the songs and arrangements of Maracatu Nações back in Brazil, who they have an exchange with, but often when those same Maracatu Nações are struggling financially and also for political and cultural recognition. So it's a huge, huge beast of a theme to engage with. And there are also religious, spiritual tensions around the connection between Candomblé, other Afro-Brazilian religions, Jurema, and Maracatu de Bapirado, which these tensions already exist in Brazil, in Pernambuco. But I think they're magnified here in the UK, where there's a very small community of people who are, not even a community of people who are practicing Candomblé or practicing African religions. It's not well known, they're not well known practices here. For many Maracatus, including the one that I play with in Brazil, the Alto do Wado, the cosmology of Candomblé is absolutely kind of fundamental to their practice as a Maracatu. So the fact that these rhythms have been exported as a primarily secular, non-religious form, art form, is seen as problematic. It can be seen as problematic. Just a little bit more, thanks. Yeah. Okay. Some other tensions that I experience are around aesthetics. So what to play, what not to play, how to play it. There's tensions between creation of new material that's inspired by Maracatu or other traditions, but whilst also honoring and respecting where the traditions have come from and who they've come from. There's the difficulties of knowing when not to represent, whether we want to use the word represent or not. For example, many groups here choose not to have a king or a queen in the cortege real do Maracatu. I won't go into the, you heard a lot from the media anyway, but out of respect for the ashe, the kind of complex spiritual potency and the historicity of those roles of the king and queen. The same with something like the Kalimba. So So there's also difficulties around creating a stage show for a London audience, or a UK audience, which involves maracatu, because as like processional carnival music, which is highly cyclical and repetitive, maracatu in Brazil as well has undergone a lot of adaptations for stage, and to create a kind of engaging stage show. And those needs, again, I think are magnified or amplified in the context of the UK audience who aren't familiar with music often. Although increasingly people, I mean, maracatu is everywhere at the moment in London, so go to the Harlem and you'll see it on Sunday if you want to. That means in terms of repertoire that often maracatu groups combine a variety of different Northeastern traditions like Koku, Apoche, Siranda, and Nanyu beats in their performances. And in fact, that's what we're going to do for you tomorrow. So this is my way of saying really that my musical and academic work sits right at the heart of all of these tensions. And I'm in a process of continual interrogation of my own practice. And so I don't have any kind of straightforward answers, and I look forward to hearing your thoughts and opinions about
that. That's really fascinating. I was struck by sort of two things. One is, it's one thing to bring a repertoire, song repertoire, or to work with styles of music, here. But it's another thing to bring a whole kind of cultural matrix almost, in its entirety. Work with that here. That's one thing, and all the complexities of that. And how do you, these are the difficulties of staging, how do you not just present, but in a sense kind of translate that to a UK audience? That's a general challenge for anybody working with any cultural form, and it's something that we're trying to work with. How do you not just translate the words, the language, translate the phenomenon itself.
And I think even more because maracatu is both
really cool, really cool.
Brazilian. I mean, right. I would like to
translate. Right. So there's that one, and I suppose related to that, it's a really interesting thing that you pointed out, talking about your partnership in Sergio Norte. The phenomenon of non-Brazilians who live in the country, who get really seriously engaged with aspects of cultural life, and then return to either their country of origin or they settle somewhere outside of Brazil, and then start to begin work with that cultural knowledge that they draw. And it's very interesting. It's quite, there's a lot of people, for example, even just at a kind of basic level, there's a lot of people in this country teaching in schools, teaching drumming, teaching forms of Brazilian drumming. That's a massive kind of phenomenon. And they're mostly Brits, aren't they? People who have been in Brazil for whatever reason. And I think that's a very interesting kind of aspect of what's going on.
Yeah.
Okay, so I think there are so many interesting questions have been thrown up. I wanted to just throw in a couple of questions for you that we can then open up to the audience that I think are pretty key. At least two of you talked about sort of funding and support. Claudia talked about the business of looking for sponsorship. He mentioned the Arts Council. And I just wanted to ask, perhaps a bit more focused way about the question of support, financial and other kinds of support from the state, from Brazil, Brazilian state through funding organizations through the embassy, levels of support from the private sector, even universities as well. I'm not just thinking of Kings, but what is your experience of that? What do you think could be improved? I know these are big questions, but I we've heard a couple of sort of positive sort of signals that you benefited a bit from some support.
Can I start? Yeah, it's quite sure. Recent. We have two supports from Arts Council. What before we start, it was very hard. I have tried many friends who have experience to have projects supported by the Arts Council or other companies, because we have lots of organizations that support and have fundings, but it's too hard to apply and to find exactly where, how can you reach the specific project they are looking, they are aiming to. And also to have the form to have this project viable for the community or whatever, is we need to have an experience and time to try. We need to, we have, until we get the last one supported by Arts Council, we tried at least 3 times. And we have reapplied and have a different people working together. And until we get exactly what they are looking for, what was good, to prove that you have an engagement. It's important because you can have a nice project, but if you don't have any engagement, that is not making the other part. Okay, it's nice, but how are you doing that? And the first one was, we are lucky to have like a project was open in our community in Chofa, that we're working with the tribe people and the community, the states. We used to live in one state, and then we meet people from the group, not only community people that have the relation with the special part of the Arts Council. And then we have lots of meetings, and then we engage with another big group. And then this time we developed this community exactly in the area of Chalk Farm, and there are other groups in different London. This is our experience in terms of funding. And the other companies, it's just a matter of you find one you feel like you're sympathetic to their aims as a company. For example, I'd like to have my name on the project that can support in kind different companies. You cannot, sometimes not money, but something that you need for the project, they offer you as a like a support in kind.
Anybody else on that? I mean, do you think there is a real kind of interest, you know, the part of the private sector in terms of supporting, you know, Brazilian companies supporting the kind of work that you do? Is that really a really difficult problem?
I mean, I live in many projects, and obviously not all of them take off as the same. Maybe you have to have a project that, for some reason, they feel the benefit. For not only for the Brazilian community, but for the local community. And I think what he said about education, work linking it, maybe offering workshops to local schools or, you know, private areas. This sort of thing does really attract, I think, the interest of companies in general. Because then it's some wider thing than just one event that happens. You will leave something behind. You know, not only the performance and the good memories and to discover some new music, but they also do some work with the community or the local. I think that's the way we need to attract a little bit more support from companies.
How about maybe the more sticky, controversial subject of state support for Brazil and cultural policy in Brazil? I mean, I was reminded, you know, a few years ago, not so very long ago, there was a kind of a development out of the local Brazilian-based Ponte de Cultura initiative.
Yeah.
Was to export that, wasn't it? And I remember, you know, hearing a little bit about your experiences.
Yeah, we had some meetings. Mm. Some meetings for Ponte de Cultura. Mm. And it was promising. Was quite interesting to have different parts of the world and have some meetings, meetings in Brasilia. People can from London to there, but unfortunately, Brazil I think from before 2003, they're going to get, like, getting worse in terms of economic plan. They're changing the, some plans to change the government, in my opinion, the way of government. And say they take more, less sources to helping, supporting active Brazilian activities in the world, despite of being very nice to promote Brazilian culture, tourism. I've been to many expositions, international expositions for the tourism, but it's quite hard because they're still dealing with some people with the money just for one thing and just for the culture. For the Minas project, we tried to the Secretaria de Cultura de Minas Gerais, so many with the secretary, or a lot of meetings, and then we have only the source from London. That's quite of controversial because of the you should support that. People say, well, why don't you have this support? Is that from your country, like in other countries, they maybe have some support, they've been sticking together. But Brazil is kind of is a different, maybe about people exploring the richness in a different way, and the arts, we kind of struggle to be exactly what we need to do exactly. And we must be very creative and to have to open, you know, our umbrella to do something more and to make it richer, to find the ways to get the products. And,
yeah, I just have a little bit to add on that actually, which is we have an interesting, experience at the Brighton Fringe recently, a project run by the man who in Brighton had received Arts Council funding, and they put together a stage show, and I was involved playing and singing, and the show was quite bizarre because it involved like there was a moment where there was some Japanese fan dancing, and there was another moment with tap dancing, like, and so I was talking to the organizer, I was like, the woman who made the application, and I was like, wow, I mean, what a crazy show, what's going on? You know, it was entertaining, but it definitely wasn't a kind of traditional Brazilian show, and she said that's what you have to do to get funding. is I have to say I'm collaborating with Japanese fan dancers and the tap dancing organization in Brighton, and
well, that takes us into sort of arena. One of the other sort of topics that was in discussion in the last panel, really, I suppose, the extent to which what you can do or what you will do, you know, in this country, in the city, is going to be shaped by expectations, by the agendas of actors that might include, well, I mean, I was wondering what you think about the way in which the big concert venues in London, to what extent they shape, you know, local expectations and tastes, as it were, as regards Brazilian music, is, you know, what difference it makes, what the program is at the Barbican or at the South Bank, and you know, to what extent you think that's kind of problematic, actually, you know, the kind of programs that are promoted, or is it simply helpful just to have the big stars of Brazilian, you know, MVP or whatever here, as just a kind of, you know, to encourage and educate. So, you know, is that to what extent is that helpful that we have these big stars coming?
Yes,
you as, you know, as people sort of working,
because they are part, they are masters. Anyway, some Arabian masters, for example, Martinho, Lestat, João Donato, they come here to bring some Latinidade of Bossa Nova, a different style of Bossa Nova than another player like Meniscal or So John Gilbert wanna perform in Barbican. So it enriches us, it brings us. It inspired us to do that. For my point of view, it's we all get excited with these people to come here, still alive, Costa Nova, because I, you know, seen from the first, the previous speech, they have a lot of people that I met personally, but they not as they passed away, like Duval Ferreira. And I met in Rio de Janeiro, monsters of Bossa Nova, but one day you see by the news, we're leaving London, oh, Chico Anísio passed away, this people, and so many people will now have noticed that they're getting old, and they, that we need to get the richness of them. And since they passed away, we cannot get them as just recordings, revive them. So I feel excited to have them here.
What happens a little bit, but then it's not so much in venues, or I don't know, is sometimes it's a bit haphazard, isn't it? The selection, the way people are, the way, basically, the people who manage to get here from Brazil, sometimes you don't quite understand, you know, why you open space for this person but not to that person, that sort of thing. I mean, sometimes it's a little bit random. There is a bit of that. I mean, who, yes, well, I wonder if I mean, the Brazilian government is not so, doesn't seem to think strategically using like soft power, using its culture as a calling card, in the way that other countries seem to do. Like for instance, you know, you have here, you have the British Council, and the British Council promotes British culture as far as I understand, understanding between the cultures. I mean, imagine if we did that. Like if we decided, okay, let's do this properly as a country, Brazil, what we could achieve, because we, I mean, the way Brazilian people, Brazilian people is perceived here, I have this feeling that British people, when they get to know Brazilian people, there is immediately this sense of relaxing, you know, it's, I think we can offer something. We do offer something quite special, and it's just so. I wonder if we were to kind of think, okay, you know, say talk about the Brazilian brand. I don't like that, but anyway, it's fashionable now. Brazilian brand. The Brazilian brand is, I mean, right now it's a little bit difficult. You know, it's so powerful. You know, and we could do so much. And create something more systematic, something a little bit more representative, not just the people who happen to have the money to kind of come over.
Well, we're some of us are thinking and talking about what, you know, a university might be able to offer, you know, within its limited resources, beyond organizing events like this. But I wanted to open it up a bit, because there are one or two people here, you know, who live in London and who have experience in, you know, in the music scene. So looking at a couple, one at the front, this boy at the back. I'm really interested to hear what Goyo thinks, because he's been here long enough now to get a sense of what's going on with Brazilian music, what some of the possibilities are.
Yeah, I think that my personal experience, I first arrived, I've been here for 2 years, and I first arrived, and I was happy to have some gigs with some Brazilian musicians here. But then I saw that it was kind of, people were too protective in terms of, there was not a kind of openness that I thought it would be in terms of sharing and collaborative projects. I understand we have a show of music is well represented, and we have some names of MPB, of course. Guy is one of the and Monica on the Bossa Nova side as well. I understand that she's doing a great job, but we all know that it's not a very large market, unfortunately. And so I think that it's kind of, you have the big names coming to perform, and you have these small niches protected by these people, fearsome and not sometimes really open. And and from my perspective, we also suffer a lot from the images of Brazil and mulattas and etc. And what really happened really changed the market, so I understood, is because venues like, there was a restaurant in East London where I started gigging, and the owner was kind of trying to have me there, but it was clearly a place where only música sertaneja was thriving, so to speak. And so I talk with musicians that are here longer than I, and they are telling me that this is a, because the major Brazilian community here, they are they like to listen to the novelas songs and very pop songs, so they are really into música sertaneja. So it's been quality music like música from Minas and Bossa Nova, and it's been it's really difficult to market it. But I was first well impressed by the numbers of different activities like maracatu, bossa nova, choro music, etc. But I think that unfortunately the Brazilian taste is kind of changing, and the crossroads between bossa nova and jazz, it's also a difficult. I am a saxophone player. I played jazz a long time ago in Brazil. Then I decided to be, as Monica said, kind of a French resistance for the Brazilian music, or um aparelho, como se dizia, the dictator, military dictatorship. So kind of to be looked at, fighting for the Brazilian music. So to conclude, I think that the London market is the Brazilian taste changed. So we have lots of venues yet where, let's say, different music like bossa nova, choro can happen. And but other, it's becoming more difficult, as I felt as the years came by. So that's my impression.
I mean, there are clearly going to be objective conditions, you know, the economics of the music market and so on, that are going to be beyond anybody's immediate control, you know, changing circumstances and so on.
Yeah.
But I wonder, something that Guy mentioned earlier on, I think it was, you were talking about the Brazilian way, I guess the jeito or whatever, of sort of doing things. And I was curious about that.
I tried to avoid this expression. Yeah. I didn't want to use jeitinho brasileiro, because there's some bad connotation on that.
But I guess you had in mind, you know, a certain just a cultural difference. We're talking about cultural difference, weren't you?
Yeah.
There are a certain way in which, you know, Brazilian artists have to work, that is significantly culturally different from sort of local approach to things. I mean, I don't know if that is that familiar to anybody else. Is that a sort of important?